So it's not for nothing that we got together here. We wanted to introduce two editions, this reprint of the first edition of Telehor magazine. It was published in 1936 for the first time, and then it was republished 2 years ago with comments. And also, we are having a small book that was published in Russian. It has also texts there, but with few illustrations, but still it gives you an idea of this fantastic work, and it was published as a collaboration of Garage Museum and Ad Marginem Publishing House. So before we start our conversation, I would like to ask Mikhail Katomin to say a few words, who represents a publisher. And he initiated publishing this Telehor magazine in Russian. Hello, good afternoon. I'm very grateful to all our guests who made it here. Unfortunately, we don't have our edition here. And I have to say that we have different things because our colleagues that came here participated in publishing the original edition of Telehor magazine. Oh, so here we are having our edition. So, like Anna said, the original Telehor was published in 1936, and it was devoted to László Moholy-Nagy, who was a theoretician, who was a photographer, who was an artist, and it's difficult to give one word to describe all his interests. And it's true that the main project is the reprint of Telehor that was published in Switzerland, and originally this magazine was published in different languages, even in the 30s, and then I found out that there's a Russian translation of those texts, so it's an ideal reader, a guide for ideas of Moholy-Nagy for about 150 pages, and when I found out about such Russian text, I wanted to publish a similar edition in our Minima series. It's like a pocket books that series that we have. It's difficult to describe what it's all about, giving just one or two words. So we are interested in theory, we are interested in archive, we are interested in essays that help us to identify the problem field of today's life. Sometimes something that is felt very relevant appeared at the beginning of this century. So that's why we don't take it as an archive, because all Moholy-Nagy ideas of the ideas of light, the ideas of surface that became the basis for the new architecture. I realize that I'm not an expert in avant-garde from academic point of view or Moholy-Nagy art. So I'm very thankful to Clemens Gruber and Oliver Botar, who really helped to publish another reprint, just take the text out of Telehor and add some illustrations there. They also published pre-word and postscript for this book, and so I'm very happy to see them here. So let's just listen to what they want to say. They'll tell us who Moholy-Nagy was and why he's so interested. So thank you for coming. Thank you very much. In Russia, Moholy-Nagy is known as a pioneer of experimental photography and as a person who was working with polygraphy. And usually in our research, he is a figure which is similar to Rodchenko on one hand and Lisitsky on the other hand. And Now we are going to see Moholy-Nagy as a theoretician, because he predicted the development of art related to technical innovations. And I was so impressed by his prophecies, because sometimes forecasts are very difficult to make, but he was so precise in predicting all those things that we can see now. And so on the one hand, we can read Moholy-Nagy's text here, and then the preface by Siegfried Gideon, who is one of the largest writers and theoreticians of modernism related to architecture in the first place. And we know him as the author of the book Space, Time and Architecture. And so this preface has an essay about the development of avant-garde culture up to 1936. And it's fantastic, really, because look, it is spiral bound. And this was the first time when they used such a spiral bound. And they used it not for technical reports like it usually which usually it's of this purpose, but for this excellent magazine. So now I would like to ask Clemens Gruber why they decided to reprint this edition and why it is relevant, why Moholy-Nagy's ideas are relevant today. Why did you want to show them again for today's readers?
Thank you very much, Anna Pronovitskaya, for your kind opening. My thanks also go to the staff of Garage, especially Elena Melkumova, and of course to Mikhail Kotomin, our Russian editor, who found a way to present Telehor at Garage, an event under the auspices of the Austrian Cultural Forum. Many thanks to Simon Mraz, the Austrian cultural attaché. First, I will give you 4 points. First, in 1936, 80 years ago, in Brno, in Czechoslovakia, an extraordinary review, Telehor, was published. Here you see the cover of a quite rotten, you could say, example. You see the front cover is loose, it's broken, which has something to do with the spiral binding, I will explain later. A journal with a striking title, Telehor, which is a kind of neologism, and it means, it's ancient Greek, it means television, telehorein, and it is a medium which hardly existed in 1936. So we know that there were experiments by technicians and that the Nazi government tried to transmit the Olympic Games in 36, but nobody could see anything in on the screen. Telehor was founded by a young Moravian architect who was 22 years old, František Kalivoda, and this first issue of the International Review of New Vision, as he called it, was entirely dedicated to László Moholy-Nagy, the Hungarian master at the Bauhaus, who in 1936 already lived in London as an immigrant. The review was published by a Swiss publishing house, Giershausen, in Zurich for, as they called it, world distribution. Giershausen guaranteed world distribution, and the journal had 300 collaborators all over the world as an advertisement announced. The journal contains four very important text by Moholy-Nagy on what we nowadays would call media theory, the first with the title From Pigment to Light, where he shows that the old arts, the pigment arts from the last at least 500 years, now change into the material of light. Then on photography, a text called Photography, A New Vision, A New Instrument of Vision. The German title is quite different. The German title would be Photography, the objektive Sehform unserer Zeit, the objective vision of our times. Then the text Problems of Modern Film, followed by supplementary comments on color and sound film. So you see all these four texts on media theory, in a way. And in addition, he published a film script called Once a Chicken, Always a Chicken, and an open letter to Kalivoda, the editor. So a letter by Moholy-Nagy to the editor, to the young Kalivoda, which starts with the sentence, Dear Kalivoda, you will ask why I surrendered arms, why I am again painting and exhibiting pictures. So this, how could you say, backlash to back from the immaterial art of light to painting. We already learned that Telehor contained a preface by Siegfried Gideon with a beautiful title, Position 1935, where he's analyzing the situation of the avant-garde. Besides these texts, and besides the situation of Brno 1936, when Czechoslovakia was surrounded by fascist or authoritarian regimes, Telehor until now is an extraordinary object as such, as a media object. It not only combines texts and images, reproductions of Moholy's works, it not only gives all the texts in four languages, first in French, so it is the old language of the arts, Paris as the capital of the 19th century, then followed by English, which was the, in advance of immigration, Moholy already was in London, and you can feel the immigration to Chicago and to the new Bauhaus, then in Czech, the language of Brno, with all the images. So for the international reader, it must have been very strange to look at the images and see these Czech texts, this Czech lettering, not understanding a single word. So all the images, more than 100 images, are in the part of the Czech text, and the Czech part also gets better paper. It gets this, how do you call it in English, the art paper. Cotted paper. So it's very bizarre for us as Western readers, or even for you as Eastern readers. And finally, the last, at the end, German. Also, all the texts were originally written in German, but in German already the Nazi regime was in power. Telehor presents itself, as you can see here, with a very unusual cover layout, which could be seen as a kind of TV test card, as the precursor even of color TV. So nowadays, as the TV stations run 24 hours a day, we don't have any test cards any longer. But I can remember very well when television started, It started at the beginning at 8 in the evening, then at 5 in the afternoon. And before that, the whole day, there were tests, a test card, first in black and white, and then also in color, like this, just for the technicians or just to fix the image of the transmission. And this could be, Oliver, the art historian, would contradict me, but I read it as a TV test card. And, as Anna already mentioned, it was spiral bound. It is somewhere around, but you can see it here, spiral bound. And here Telehor emphasizes its industrial character, the artistic appropriation of industrial design, as spiral binding was originally invented for handbooks, for catalogs, for manuals, for industrial purposes. Second, reading Moholy's texts in other books or other editions, like in Christina Paschel's monography, we found the references to Telehor. But we couldn't find the journal of 1936 in any Austrian library. It didn't exist. So when I finally found a copy, even two copies, in the Pratt Institute in Brooklyn, in New York, I was so stunned by its beauty that we immediately decided with our friends, with Oliver, to make a reprint. And we again found a Swiss publisher, Lars Müller in Zurich, who did with us the reprint, which you can see here. Third, of course, we did research in Brno, in the Museum of Brno, and we found a lot of material. We found letters of Moholy to Kaliwoda, and we found proof corrections. We found six generations of proof corrections, so we even understood how the texts were made, how the texts were set up. And so we decided, as a result of our research, to make a second volume, which is here on the table. And oh, here also, this is the original version of the original Telehor, which was covered by very thin paper, which of course, during the times, got lost. Oliver has a copy with this very thin cover paper to make it also a precious object. And there was also a private edition of Moholy, just for his friends, and it was made all in black, just with his name on the front page. And so here now, we made the reprint with Lars Müller, and we made this second volume, a commentary volume, containing the results of our research in Brno and elsewhere, and additional for languages. And we decided to add Spanish, Chinese, Russian, because of the strong influence of Russian arts, Russian constructivism on Moholy, and finally Hungarian for Moholy. And our editor didn't, when he proposed for additional languages, he said, no, you are crazy, we don't do that. But at the end, Oliver convinced him, or we convinced him to do that. And so we have these additional four languages. Fourth, in those days, suddenly I got an email from Mikhail Kotomin asking for the permission for a separate Russian publication of our Russian translation. And of course, we were very happy and honored that our reprint was a kind of book producing machine, and that there will be a Russian edition. We just asked for, we gave the permission with two conditions. First, I'm sure you remember, we asked for a postscript, that we could write a postscript, and Mikhail said, oh, that's easy. For us it was difficult. And secondly, we asked for a presentation in Moscow. And Mikhail answered, yes, we only have a garage. So we have a garage for the book now. We are here. And in the Russian edition, I want to tell you, you get both. You get all the texts of Moholy, Gideon, Kalivoda, and you get the results of our research. Thank you very much.
Спасибо.
Thank you very much, Clemens. Now I would like to give the floor to Oliver Botar. We'll later have a chance to ask questions to all the speakers.
Here it is. Sorry, Anna.
So Oliver is an expert in culture of Eastern and Southern Europe and avant-garde culture and art, modernism of the early and middle 20th century. He specializes on Hungary, and I hope that Oliver will tell us about international context for László's work in his work in Bauhaus and his connections with Russia. He never visited Russia, as far as I know, but he communicated with Russian colleagues, and in some of his texts we can find some evidence that he was dreaming of his ideas being realized in the Soviet Union. So now I would like to hear these details from the expert, from Oliver Botar.
Спасибо, Анна. So I would like to talk, yes, give some context. I don't know, I didn't want to do too much context because it would take too long. I want to focus actually on a little bit about on who Moholy-Nagy was and then on his Russian connections, but also a little bit on the Hungarian background, which is very significant in his case. So we've heard already that early in 1936 this remarkable publication appeared in Brno, in Czechoslovakia, and you've also heard already that it was edited at the time by this 23 years old, and he also designed it. It's very beautifully designed. Of course, the level of graphic design in Czechoslovakia was very sophisticated, and we can see this also in this publication. Moholy-Nagy was one of the most influential thinkers, designers, and art teachers of the first half of the 20th century. He had been hired in 1923 by Walter Gropius to teach at the Bauhaus and founded the new Bauhaus in Chicago in the United States in 1937. And you have to understand what a radical move this was on the part of Walter Gropius in 1923, because Moholy-Nagy had never gone to art school. He studied law, actually, in Budapest. He had been a practicing artist for all of 5 years at that time, and he had never taught in his life. He had never done metal work, and he was hired to be the master of the metal department, of the metalworking department. And he spoke German with a very heavy Hungarian accent. So the other masters of the Bauhaus were outraged at Gropius for hiring this guy, and he did take a risk. But finally they agreed, and the risk paid off handsomely, as a matter of fact. A pioneer of multidisciplinary art practice, he opposed, and this is very important, he opposed the traditional hierarchies of artistic media. He theorized what became known as expanded cinema, so multiple screen projections simultaneously of film, and began to think in terms of systems and of materiality with respect to art. In these ways, he helped to lay the groundwork for the post-World War II digital medial shift in artistic practices. By the mid-20s, Moholy-Nagy had realized that the reproducibility of works in all media, new and old, visual and oral, the proliferation of advertising and propaganda through the mass media, such as periodicals, films, radio, even emergent television, as we heard, and the concentration of human activity in an increasingly urbanized world had placed us into a fundamentally new situation. And this situation was one of sensory overload, so the sensory overload of modernity. He ascertained, furthermore, that this new condition was one that required training in order to be able to adapt to it. This is why, rather than making art per se, his main concern was pedagogical, an education of the senses, as he called it, in conjunction with the transformation of society. And we should emphasize here that it was not only the sense of vision that Moholy-Nagy had in mind in various of his writings, but in various of his writings he addressed the question of acoustic proprioceptive, that is to do with the inner body feelings, kinesthetic, to do with your sense of motion, and the haptic, the sense of touch as well. The white-hot energy of the 1920s avant-garde had cooled by the early 30s, but Kalivoda, whose career was just then beginning, recognized Moholy-Nagy's importance. On the eve of totalitarianism, Telehor renewed the question of the avant-garde: how do technical innovations generate aesthetic possibilities? In Telehor, the great promises of modernism were reassessed and projected into the future. Indeed, in the title Telehor, as we heard, a Greek neologism coined by Moholy-Nagy's compatriot Dinesh Mihai, refers to future expanded mass communication. This new medium combining radio and cinema emerged in several places simultaneously. By the mid-20s, European artists and intellectuals were debating the prospects of distance vision. And by the 30s, the experimental phase of television shifted towards regular broadcasting. Mihai's device transmitted still images over short distances. And while we don't know whether Moholy-Nagy was present at the first demonstration, which was at the Gellért Hotel in Budapest during the Hungarian Soviet Republic in 1919, there is a poster for it in the Palm Room of the Gellért Hotel in the middle of this second socialist republic in the world. He did refer to it in his first book, Painting, Photography, Film, which was published in 1925. Kalivoda proposed a thoroughly Moholian program for Telehor in its first promotional brochure, which you can see here, a quote, international journal for optical culture that was to publish material in a wide range of media, including film, photography, architecture, painting, sculpture, and theater, as well as, quote, all mechanical arts. He conceived of it, furthermore, as a vehicle to promote the work of individual figures of the international avant-garde who engaged with new media and whom he saw as serving the larger goal of the transformation of society. And it's interesting to note that originally he was going to devote the first issue to Hannah Hirsch. This itself is a revolutionary, move on his part to devote the first issue of a journal to a woman artist who was also working in an interdisciplinary fashion. It didn't come together, we don't know why, but then in the end it was Moholy-Nagy who was featured in the first issue. He wrote, quote, I could do no better than select the rich and many-sided work of one artist, L. Moholy-Nagy, whose versatility can scarcely be rivaled among his fellow artists of today. This is what he wrote in the postscript. Kalivoda reiterated the transmedial program outlined in the brochure, relating it to the question of abstract art and its role in what he saw as the coming socialist society. Kalivoda was actually a communist. And now I'd like to say a few words about Moholy's relations with Russia and Russian artists. Though he never visited Soviet Russia, Moholy-Nagy had multiple contacts with it. His thinking and art were strongly influenced by the Russian avant-garde, particularly the constructivists and the suprematists, as well as by the notion, the concept of technologia of Alexander Bogdanov, the founder of the Proletkult movement. And he was many other things. Bogdanov was really quite an amazing, amazing man. Moholy had been part of Lajos Kossak's activist circle in Budapest just before and during the Hungarian Soviet Republic, which lasted exactly 133 days, so it was quite short, in 1919. Other members of the activists included the artist Béla Uyts, who is actually known in Russia, I think, to some extent, Kossak's, who was also Kossak's brother-in-law, and Moholy-Nagy's friend, the art historian and critic Alfred Kemeny, better known as Durush later on, who also moved to Russia eventually. All of them emigrated after the fall of the Budapest Soviet to Vienna. Uyts and Kemeny were already members of the Hungarian Communist Party, so in Vienna, the Hungarian Communist Party, in exile, decided to send them as delegates to the Third Comintern to Moscow in 1921. They went and they developed close contacts with the constructivists. Actually, specifically, they saw the first constructivist exhibition. Kemeny also became associated with INKUCH, the Institute for Artistic Culture, I think is what it stands for, where he actually gave a series of lectures late in 1921. And I'm assuming he gave the lectures in German because I don't think that he knew any Russian at that time, although we may find out soon whether he did or not. Though, as far as we know, he never joined the Communist Party, Moholy-Nagy was, for all intents and purposes, a communist at this time. And I think a bit more than a fellow traveler, in my opinion, until he joined the staff of the Bauhaus in 1923. And I see a little bit of crypto-communist iconology, for example, in this painting of his Architektur Eins. This was noticed actually by my mother-in-law, I'm embarrassed to say, that she said, doesn't that look a little bit like a hammer and sickle? But also, I'm just citing as a bit of evidence here, because there's a big denial about Moholy-Nagy having been a communist in Hungary and in the West, in general, in the United States. This is seen as being some kind of black mark on his CV and on his curriculum vitae. But I cite here a portrait done in his own expressionist style of a person, a member, a Hungarian communist by the name of Katz, and it's dedicated to Comrade Katz. So, you know, you can draw your own conclusions, I guess. Now, Béla Uyts personally informed Moholy-Nagy of suprematism and constructivism on his way back from Moscow to Vienna in September of 1921, when he stopped off in Berlin, where Moholy-Nagy was living. Uyts later published, and he showed him all this material, which nobody had seen before in the West, and Uyts later published such material in his journal Etchig, or Unity, in Vienna in 1922, which was the first publication of such material in the West. I want to emphasize, though, if those Malevich works look a little bit strange, it's because the only way that Uyts was able to reproduce them was to produce lino cuts himself on the basis of Malevich's works and publish those. And here you can see some more images. Again, these are the first time anybody had a chance in the West to see these images were in a very obscure Hungarian magazine that was published in Vienna and probably read by 25 people who were all arguing with each other anyway. So I don't know how many people saw it, although quickly the images were picked up actually also in the German-speaking world. And we can see immediately, I mean, in his work that Moholy was looking at the works of the Stenberg brothers, of Jogansson, and was thinking these ideas through in his own ways. So this access to this material gave him a real advantage in Berlin, where constructivism was at that point just emerging as the latest trend in art. Of course, there was also Lisitsky, who arrived early in 1922. Moholy met him immediately and befriended him. They remained friends for a few years. And Moholy, what Moholy-Nagy did not pick up from Lisitsky personally, he could have learned by perusing the Berlin journal Vesch, edited by Lisitsky and by Ilya Ehrenburg. And Ilya Ehrenburg became one of Moholy-Nagy's closest friends, actually, along with Siegfried Gideon and Alvar Aalto. These were some of his closest friends during the 1930s, 20s and 30s. Okay. And then, of course, there was the first Russian exhibition in the Galerie von Diemen in Berlin, where Moholy-Nagy would have had the first chance to see original works, apart from the works that he saw of Ivan Punyi. But Punyi really was in Berlin at the time, wasn't a constructivist. He had a chance to see Lisitsky's works, perhaps, in his studio. But otherwise, this was his first opportunity to see a large number of works by the members of the Russian avant-garde. But even works such as this, which was shown in Berlin in 1923 by Lisitsky, really expanded Moholy-Nagy's concept of what art could be. And I would list as the most important influences on Moholy-Nagy at this time, Raoul Hausmann, this Austrian theorist and kind of madman who did all kinds of different things. Also Kurt Schwitters, the German Dadaist, and then Lisitsky. I think these are three very important influences for Moholy-Nagy because they expanded his concept of what art could be, what could be called art. Lisitsky later accused Moholy-Nagy of appropriating the work and thought of Russian suprematism and constructivism without giving proper credit. It's true that both Malevich's and Lisitsky's work, as well as the work of the Jogansen brothers and others, were very important to the development of Moholy-Nagy's painting and sculpture. But it's also true that Moholy always acknowledged this. In all his books, there are lots and lots of footnotes and reproductions of works by Lisitsky and Malevich and others. Also, it should be noted that Moholy, in his obsession with light and therefore with transparency, really the original input into contemporary painting at that time for him was the depiction of transparency, which for him was also a way of projecting, if you don't mind me using this term, projecting into the future a future light of pure projected colored light. So a future painting of pure projected colored light. So this is what he was proposing here. And and by the way, six of Moholy-Nagy's works were included in the first German artistic exhibition shown in Moscow, Leningrad, and Saratov in 1924. Was it shown in Leningrad? Actually, I'm not sure right now. I just got this image from Tatiana Afrusi not an hour ago. I actually originally had a black slide here because I could not find any images even of the city of Saratov at that time. So thank you, Tatiana, for providing this image. And this is the first time I've ever seen which paintings were exhibited. So these are all very significant works that were exhibited here. Moholy's and Kemmein, Alfred Kemmein, collaborated closely during 1922. So Kemmein lectured at Inkuch and then came back to, moved to Berlin, where he lived until 1933. Through Kemmein, Moholy-Nagy absorbed the ideas of Bogdanov and Technologia. Together in 1922, they published a manifesto, Dynamic Constructive System of Energies, or Energy System, which in my view is heavily Bogdanovian. And I worked on this manifesto for years and I could never understand it until Charlotte Douglas, who might be somebody known to some of you, an American scholar of the Russian avant-garde, pointed out Bogdanov to me in Technologia, and then suddenly I began to understand what they were talking about. In this sense, Naum Gabo, who accused Moholy-Nagy and Kemmein of plagiarizing their realistic manifesto, because they call for movement in this manifesto. Moholy-Nagy and Kemmein call for movement the way that Gabo did and his brother. But there is no trace of Bogdanovian thinking in the realistic manifesto. So while it was a factor in their work, I think that really they moved beyond it as well. Whoops, sorry. A number of authors have pointed out that the kinetic constructive system, this proposal for a kind of almost like a fairground ride, like a play space for adults. Resemble the Tatlin's model of the tower, the monument to the Third International. I think that in a sense, Moholy-Nagy is almost lightly poking fun at it, because while the tower was going to be this unbelievable, oversized behemoth in Moscow, had it ever been built, which of course would have been impossible, Moholy-Nagy's 12-story tower would have been a place for physical activity, for play, with his spiral ramps and so on. Now, Kemin, who had become famous in Berlin as the communist art critic Durush, moved to Moscow in 1933, where he lived until he returned to Hungary immediately after the war. And by the way, if any of you have any tips for me, I'm trying to find information on him. We know almost nothing about him, about his stay in Russia. Please see me after the lecture and give me those tips. I'd be happy to hear from you. And Moholy-Nagy also met Mayakovsky on one of Mayakovsky's visits to Berlin, was very impressed with him, and he made this famous portrait later used on the cover of Jakobson's book on Mayakovsky, for example. But also, as I mentioned, he became a very close friend of Ilya Ehrenberg. Ehrenberg, in fact, they planned a film together in 1929, which didn't come to fruition, but this demonstrates how closely they were thinking about working together. And as is well known, Walter Gropius hired Moholy-Nagy to the Bauhaus early 1923 to teach the introductory course and lead the metal workshop, and also to edit the Bauhaus Bücher series, which you can see all of the issues of here. In 1923, he wrote to Alexander Rodchenko a famous letter where he asks Rodchenko to produce a book in the series on the Soviet avant-garde, and this was not realized, but it's an amazing letter. He did ask Malevich when Malevich came through Berlin for a text, and this is the first book published of Malevich's texts in the West. And naturally, he published a book also of Kandinsky's pedagogical writing. But also, he was blown away, to use an English term, by Man with a Movie Camera, Gigavato's film. He was absolutely stunned by this film, and he did everything he could to have this film shown all over Germany. And he actually even arranged for it to be shown, projected onto the inner surface of a planetarium in Hanover, so it was projected onto a concave surface actually in Hanover. And Moholy's views on photography were formulated in 1924 and published in 1925 in this remarkable book, which is really one of the first important manifestos of media theory of the 20th century. And in this book, he called for the photographer to fully exploit the technical capabilities of the camera. In other words, to turn away from pictorialism, which was a dominant photographic style at the time. He also advocated the photographer's look to non-art photography, to applied photography, to scientific photography, to technical photography, criminological photography, anything but art photography as their inspiration. And Moholy-Nagy's photographs appeared occasionally in Soviet journals, as we heard from Anna. This is how he was known here mostly. He was published in Novi Lev, Nova Generatsiya out of Ukraine, but his most significant publication in Russian was the Russian edition of Malerai Photography Film, which appeared in 1929. It translated by, I guess, Alexander Telashev in the series Library of the Soviet Photo. And this is the first publication of this cornerstone of 20th century media theory in a language other than German. So in fact, this is very important. It was first, outside of the German-speaking world, it was first published as a book in Russia. It was also published, parts of it were published in Hungarian by that time, but as a book, this is the first place where it was published. So it didn't have much resonance at the time, but this was an important precedent also for us to choose Russian as one of the languages we wanted to translate the book into. And I want to just point you also, if you want to know more about Moholy-Nagy's Russian connections, see the article by the late Yuri Gerchuk in his book László Moholy-Nagy in the Russian Context, published by Tvikat Kvadata in 2006, which was a wonderful product. Thank you very much for your attention.
Спасибо большое, Оливер.
Thank you very much, Oliver. It's fantastic. Very complicated connections, the structure of connections. And it was very different from what happened later, after the Second World War, when the world became bipolar. And it's also very different from today's system of global cultural connections, which is dominated by English-speaking world, because today everybody speaks English, and that's the major feature of it. So the next part of our meeting is going to be about the participation of Moholy-Nagy in a very important international project, and that's a film. So here we can see him not as a theoretician, but as a filmmaker. And this film is about the fourth International Congress of Modern Architecture, SIAM. And I would like to ask Wolfgang Beilenhoff to introduce this film. He is from International Research Institute of Cultural Technologies and Media Philosophy in Weimar, Germany. Wolfgang is a film expert and expert in technical media. And today he is going to give his view as a film critic, as a film historian, and so we're going to see this film from the technological innovations point of view. But since this film is dedicated to Siam Congress, I wanted to say that could probably explain why Moholy-Nagy decided to make this film. So the International Congress of Modern Architecture, SIAM, that's a French abbreviation, the first congress took place in Switzerland, and it was congress was set up in 1928. When Corbusier lost his project to build the League of Nations building. So they had this idea that the architects from different countries should get together to promote their program, to interact together with the governments, and help disseminate the principles of modern architecture and urban planning. They dealt with mass housing and residential building, but they were also interested in urban planning. At first, they thought that their congresses would take place annually, because the second congress took place in 1929, the third one in 1930, but then they found it quite difficult to organize such international meetings, especially that they were going to publish the results of every congress. So they decided to hold their congresses biennially, once every 2 years. So they were going to have another congress in Moscow. Due to many reasons, many of you probably know that Le Corbusier's project was rejected in Geneva, and then it was used as a design for the House of Unions in Moscow. It was redesigned and reworked for a new place and for a new program. Soviet architects had to participate in Siam, but they couldn't make it to the first Congress. They probably couldn't get their visas. And Moisey Ginsburg, El Lisitsky, and Nikolai Kolya were around them. As you know, Nikolai Kolya was an architect who was actually implementing that design of the Palace of the Unions. And by the 1930s, some participants of Siam were actually working in the Soviet Union, because the rest of the world had a grave depression, whereas in the Soviet Union we had industrialization underway, lots of construction and development. So the first three congresses were about typology of mass housing construction. And so they came to a conclusion that multi-story building, multi-apartment buildings were the principal way to develop, and they were to be surrounded by lots of trees and greenery, so they had to develop multifunctional areas like recreation, production, transport, and housing. So they had to specify this concept, and they were going to do it at the next Congress. They had some working meetings in between Congresses, and in Berlin in 1931, they had a special meeting for the next Congress, but Soviet participants couldn't come there. But some instructions from the USSR were sent there, and they said that the principles for cities were to be based on social city principles that were formulated by Nikolai Milutin. It's a famous book that he wrote about the construction of socialist cities. And also Le Corbusier edition on urban planning was published in the Soviet Union as part of preparations for Siam Congress. But then there were some complications. Center Soyuz, the commissioner for Le Corbusier, was to be one of the key participants, but they couldn't get the invitation on time. And Center Soyuz had very difficult period, because some people, some leaders were arrested, so that's why the construction works stopped. And instead of going to Moscow, they decided to hold this intermediate meeting in Barcelona, where they developed the plan for Barcelona reconstruction. And that's where they found out the results about the competition for the Palace of Unions in Moscow, because Le Corbusier was sure that he would win, because his design project already once won the competition. But when the most conservative projects were appreciated, it became a real turning point when they stopped the avant-garde. Because it was clear that there was a turn towards more academic, historized architecture. So that's when the people started writing letters to the Union of Architects and Stalin, saying that you have made a big mistake and you will be sorry about that. And Siegfried Gideon sent a telegram to Stalin that Le Corbusier dictated. that they think now that Moscow is not a good place for the Siam Congress, since it was about building the functional city. But the Soviet side, the Soviet party, didn't really respond to it, and it became clear that this meeting won't take place. At first it was postponed until 1933, and Gideon came to Moscow and some other participants from Siam, Hans Schmidt, Ernst May, and Marstam and Meyer, they were four. So they participated in that meeting together with Mikhail Ginsburg and Visnin and Nikolai Kolle. So they were hoping that they would have this Congress. And Gideon wrote Le Corbusier that having this Congress in the Soviet Union would be extremely important to support modern architecture, which is now in opposition. But it turned out to be impossible, and so they had to find another place very quickly. And as we know, the famous Fourth Congress of Siam that developed the principles for modern urban planning took place on a cruise ship. So in 1933, they went on board Patris II and went to Athens, where they developed the principles for modern city construction. They were published after the Congress, and then finally they were transformed into the Athens Charter, and Corbusier finalized that text, and then published it in 1943 in Vichy's France, hoping that those principles would be used for post-war restoration works and reconstruction. And so later on, the cities in the Soviet Union and the Eastern Bloc countries joined the same charter, because before that they were following the principles of the 19th century in city construction. So this is my comment, which is related to Moholy-Nagy's film, and now I would like to give the floor to the film expert.
Okay. Thank you very much for the invitation to circle some general ideas and then some focuses concerning the film you just spoke about, or the journey. And there's a question, are ships the best places for developing new theory or new insights? And in general, I think it's worth to place Moholy in the context of contemporary media situations. And you just spoke about, and Oliver, about an expanded cinema. And my question is, what's going on when cinema is getting liberated from the screen as a single picture and is expanded into different material media, for example, smartphones or multiple screens or something? And what's going on there? That's, I think, a very strong idea by Moholy. And the same problem for me, or the same productive perspective on Moholy, is linked with his insights and thoughts about light. And it's fascinating to read him, and reading his reflections about light is not any material phenomenon, but it's a pure medium. And to precise this, I remembered a picture from one documentary. I think it's from 48, the fifth, some birthday of Stalin, and you see, we are seeing clouds in the air, and there's a portrait of Stalin projected onto the clouds. And there isn't anything material. If there's a wind blowing and the balloons are disappearing, the picture is disappearing too. And so you could say he's, Moholy is some kind of precursor of later media theory, for example, Marshall McLuhan, or contemporary reflection about media aren't any material phenomena, but they are some kind of go-between. And the medium is the message, as McLuhan said, but for Moholy, medium is not the message, it's some kind of an aesthetic perspective and aesthetic instrument. And it's quite fascinating to looking from the present, looking back to Moholy and see how his film, for example, Ein Lichtspiel, that means a light play, what is that? Black, white and grey, and it's a film only only focusing on what's reflections of light, phenomena which are purely visual, and so underlining the importance of visuality. And this would be a third approach to connect Moholy with contemporary theory of, for example, so picture studies, a pictorial turn which has taken place the last decade, and where the question is, are there specific possibilities in pictures to give us information or to invite us to affect us, emotional responses and things like this. And this could be, under this, an aspect of education you spoke about. One real and interesting perspective. And concerning education is it's a wonderful idea, because I remembered when you spoke about this, I remembered one some notes by Jean-Luc Godard when he spoke about film is it's not only entertainment, it's not entertainment, it's some kind of education, that means education of the senses. How can we get another approach to the things we are looking at? The film, we will, only these short remarks to this general questions, and the film we will see now, an Architects Congress is, as you just mentioned, it's a film commanded by CM, and it's a film which is combining the two aesthetic poles of Moholy's thinking, the pole of the experimental and the pole of the documentary. And the result is quite an interesting combination, some kind of co-presence of documentary and experimental. And this combination you will notice in every shot, there are movements, camera movements, which aren't describing but are manifestations of movement as movement. And the close-ups of faces, and you will recognize the faces of the face of local Le Corbusier. He is picture portrait or pictured there, and at the same time, as Oliver will recognize, I think, is Gideon. You are recognizing him. And concerning Gideon, maybe as a footnote, he is the author of this fascinating book about the mechanization of the Gaspotzwa Mechanisation, the power of the mechanization. And he is present there, and Kalivoda, we can see him too. And concerning the third figure of the Telehor Troika, speak it that way, Moholy-Nagy, he is hidden, but he is present at the same time. He is hidden behind the camera, like Werther's cameraman, And at the same time, we are noticing him and we are building a picture of what a person is he by seeing what he is underlining by showing them. And so we could see, or we will recognize him by seeing his films with his eyes, and I wish you a good projection.
Спасибо.
Okay. These are quotations from his film about the Marseille, old harbor of Marseille.
It's a kind of immigration of the avant-garde. And a kind of pre-enactment of immigration which we fought.
Siam started architectural exhibitions using different pads with the same size. And here we can see analytical urban plans.
Siegfried Gideon. It's always struck me, one of the things that's always struck me about this film is how crowded this boat is. And everybody is on everybody's back and on the floor, under tables, everywhere. In a sense, I've always thought of this as a kind of metaphor for what was happening with the avant-garde at the time. It was being increasingly squeezed out of Germany, squeezed out of the Soviet Union into this kind of tiny space.
The same happens in Italy. In 1931, Siam participants thought that Mussolini supported modern architecture, but by 1933 the situation changed completely, and so Empire Neoclassics was back on stage.
I think it's important to note that Moholy-Nagy's play with focus and lack of focus was something very new at that time, and he wrote about it. For him, an image that was out of focus was not a bad image, because it was part of what the camera was capable of. It was part of it demonstrated what the camera was capable of, and it produced a certain haptic effect. So he had no compunctions whatsoever about including images that in any other circumstances would have been seen as being defective in some way.
But he had a very professional camera, a 35 one.
Yes. Also, it was very important for him that he was handheld. That he didn't always use a tripod, because this introduced this Wolfgang was saying, that this personal perspective, this personal vision, so that his presence, just through the jitteriness of the holding of the camera, becomes more palpable.
And Oliver, what do you think about the quotation of the cities that the persons are coming from? Is there an underlining the international aspect of avant-garde? This person is coming from Milano, the other one from Barcelona,
absolutely.
And Zurich, and so on.
Absolutely, and he really, because there are very few intertitles actually, and it's actually kind of strange what isn't intertitled. Many things aren't intertitled. Yes, he's emphasizing the international nature, but he's also always emphasizing the cramped nature. So this kind of, and I don't know whether it was intentional or not, but there it is. So these people from all over the world are being, you know, are squeezed into this small space where they have these, on the other hand, they have these great ideas for cities. So there's kind of a contraction and an expansion at the same time. What's so beautiful about these images of the Isthmus of Corinth is that they kind of form us a bookend to the images of the Pont Transbordeur in Marseille, this technical marvel that, as you mentioned, Wolfgang, that he had made a part of another film is about that, and it appears in his photography as well. Mm-hmm. I also think of the boat as kind of a safe, neutral space. It's interesting, for example, that the Greek they don't land and then meet the Greek delegation. The Greek delegation leaves Greek land and then goes on to the boat. Yeah. So there's this. It's kind of like this magical space, this special space.
So, comparing a modern architecture and traditional residential buildings is an attempt of Le Corbusier that he took a trip to the Middle East. So, he based his works on Mediterranean houses and Acropolis. You probably remember drawings of Le Corbusier, the drawings of Acropolis, because it was like the starting point for him. It was the example of the most perfect architecture.
And I know I remember Hattula Moholy-Nagy, the artist's daughter, telling me how deeply Moholy-Nagy was moved by seeing this ancient architecture, which is not surprising for a typical, you know, Central European person with a classical education, you know, who took some Greek and for whom really this was the basis, I think, of civilization also, as well as a kind of starting point for technology. So it's not by accident that he devotes an entire section of the film to the Acropolis and to the Parthenon in specific.
Yeah. It seems to be some kind of analytical approach, to get out the structure of columns and spaces. It's totally different from a normal photography of showing some kind of temple or
yes, it's the details, the structural details. Yeah. He's focusing also in the erecteion, as we can see here, as he moves beyond the Parthenon.
It's a big paradox that the official opening happened after the Congress was finished, because most of the discussions took place on the ship.
He does his best to capture this floodlit Acropolis, which of course is right up his alley as far as a light projection goes. But the camera technology of the day wasn't really good enough to be able to capture it in a way that would be particularly reflect the experience that he had. But I think it's significant that the architecture that one sees is, as Anna pointed out, traditional architecture, it's classical architecture, and it's industrial architecture. But everything else is only by accident. So any contemporary architecture that wasn't international style, it's only by accident that we see it. So those, it's really so telling of where his interests and where the interests, I think, of his contemporary colleagues lay were. And the landscapes are always, almost always mediated by something, something in the field of vision that enters in the foreground, something human-made, whether it's a chain or whether it's a girder or whether it's a bridge or something. Yeah. He avoids a straight landscape. Mm-hmm.
And are there statements about the special architecture here in Santorin? Because it's so fascinating. It's a modern, traditional architecture, but with a very strong modern outside.
Кикладская архитектура особенно привлекала внимание, на самом деле, не только Корбюзье, но и других.
It's true that it was. Interesting not only for Le Corbusier, but for others as well. And it's white and blue, so it's a cubic composition. And there is an ideal communication or interaction with the landscape and the area relief.
That's a total unexpected perspective. In bird view, though, to get out the structure of this another social place.
And we should remember that this was a commissioned film by Gideon, so it wasn't just a travelogue or an idea on Moholy-Nagy's part. He was invited to make this film as a document to the Congress, so that gives it a kind of travelogue kind of sense. But I really like what you said about this tension between the documentary travelogue and the experimental, which was so typical of almost every one of his films, as were shots always of animals. I'm surprised there are no cats in this film, because he almost always has a cat or two in his films. He loved cats, but we see the dogs, the donkeys.
Yeah,
the
There's so much empathy in these shots, showing people who are sleeping and lying there and very sympathetic.
In fact, except for light play black, white, gray, his films are human-centric. They are they focus on people, and even sometimes using the face, as he put it, he said the face is itself a light modulator.
Yeah.
So, but it's also a human approach as well as a formal approach.
And it's a very strong way of interacting. And we don't know what they are speaking about, but they are in a strong communication by facing these, or by structuring the picture and contrasting faces which are facing together.
Here is his beloved Pontons Bordeaux, which he photographed obsessively as well.
Oh, thank you very much for the copy, Oliver.
My pleasure.
Okay.
Большое спасибо за возможность посмотреть этот фильм и за ваши комментарии.
Thank you very much for your comments. Thank you for showing this film.
И это прекрасная иллюстрация к текстам,
которые It's a beautiful illustration to the texts that are published in Telehor.
Мы сейчас, видимо, перейдем к вопросам и ответам.
But I guess we have now to ask the audience to ask their questions. But before that, let me ask my question.
Очевидно, что вот в этом
It's clear that his moving camera, the cuts that he's got, different stories that he shows, there are some connections with Дига Вертов's works. Of course, László knew Дига Вертов's works, but he often criticized Дига Вертов for his many cuts, whereas he himself is trying to get together different stories when the person looks from one side to another, when the ship is moving on the wave. So I'm not an expert. It looks so natural. So I'd love to ask you to draw this comparison between László Moholy-Nagy and Вертов.
Oliver.
Okay, sure. I can start the conversation. I mean, I couldn't help thinking about Дига Вертов actually as I was watching now. In fact, I think there is one little quotation. The person waking up and rubbing their eyes is a reference to Man with a Movie Camera. Yes, I think that I mean, as I said, Moholy-Nagy really was amazed by this film, by this really amazing film. It still amazes me every time I see it, Man with Movie Camera. But yes, his aesthetic intentions were different. I think that he was trying to show relationships, a kind of continuity, and then again these long shots. I mean, he really this reminds me of Miklós Jancsó in the 1960s and these very, very long shots. And I don't know whether Jancsó even had access to these films to be able to quote them. But there is a very different aesthetic. Of course, it was a very different purpose as well in the case of this film. But if I think of the other films, I can think of, for example, the Big City Gypsies, Großstadtzigeuner film, where he tries to enter into relationship, a very close relationship and a spontaneous relationship with those he is filming. And there's this one wonderful scene in that film where, which is we see some analogies here, where he squats with the camera on his shoulder, and the Roma people are dancing all around him, and he is then kind of dancing with the camera. He spins with the camera and interacts with them in a very kind of, in a way that lessens the almost, or reduces the inevitable objectification of the person that the camera vision, that the camera eye imposes on the situation.
Yeah. It's quite interesting, the long shot is the opposite of the montage procedure. And the long shot, that means there isn't any splitting of the action or the person who is moving, and so we are given a much more continuous insight into a phenomenon or into a person. And Bazin in the 50s, he spoke about the difference between long shot and montage, and montage is creating a new sense for something, but the long shot is showing we are liberated from looking for some kind of generated meaning. And concerning this problem of the question of aesthetics, I found it now very interesting, this an opposition between a movie, home movie approach. For example, when normal daily life is shown, or the people are leaving a place, and in general, the persons on the ship, and this experimental, and the experimental analytical approach, for example, this the presentation of buildings and architecture in general is so stunning, and it's so unexpected, and on the contrary of every home movie. Home movies are made for getting a personal memory of something, but this maybe association to a home movie is isn't that false? Because it gives us the impression the people who are living there this week or 2 weeks, spending this time together on the ship, they belong together, and there's some kind of family life between them, or theory giving, or the ship as birthplace for developing new theoretical insights. And so there's a constant go between these two poles for me.
Maybe just two remarks to that comparison between Vertov and Moholy-Nagy. First of all, I think The Man with the Movie Camera is the summa of silent film, so there is no comparison to that film. And Moholy-Nagy was not a professional filmmaker, so there could be a comparison with earlier films of Sigurd Vertov, maybe some editions of Kinopravda, where you also have these long shots and first looking at it, it seems boring, but then you realize that there is a constant analytic approach or desire even about the medium itself, about the film itself, and that we could see in Architects Congress. And the second, of course, there is also a structural narrative in Architects Congress. So the first part is the Congress on the boat, with all what you said about it, the movement and the Congress where people speak to an auditorium. So we have this structure. Then the Congress in Athens, which is very short and has no sense, no meaning at all. But the middle part is architecture. So the result of the Congress is shown by traditional Greek architecture, which is very close to Bauhaus. And then the return, the third part, where the result, in between there is this intermedium of awakening, that's a Vertov, yes, awakening of perception in Vertov. But then when the Congress goes back to Marseille, people speak about the results of the Congress, about the Charta, they type and they, face to face, they distribute the Charta of Athens. So I think it is a very beautiful montage Moholy did.
It's much more rich than you expect in the beginning. Yeah? Yeah. It seems to be quite a, some kind of documentary feature, and then it develops into a reflection
but
space and architecture.
Sorry.
Yeah.
No, but I think our audience has to know why we screened this film this afternoon. And it is because the editorial board of Telehor, the three main protagonists, maybe met for the first time on the boat, or they spoke about Telehor. They invented Telehor on these boats, on this
journey.
Yes, they invented a journal in four languages on the Mediterranean, and I guess this is also important.
So we have to move to find out new ways.
Because we should also mention that František Kalivoda was, I believe, the Secretary General of Siam Ost, so of the East Central European Siam groups, the Hungarian, the Polish, the Czechoslovakian, and I'm not quite sure which others there were. But he was actively involved. So yes, there was a...
He was of the Leva Front.
Leva Front, but also Secretary General of Sirpak, I think it was called, Sirpak. So yes, the genesis of Telehor seems to be connected with this and or the Chateau La Sarraz, Switzerland, where they also would meet. So yeah, I think what you were saying, Clemens, was really wonderful, and it made me think of that there are two parallel journeys here. There is a journey, there is the home movie, and on the other hand, so the actual trip, because he includes the return, but this is also the metaphor for this process of creating the Athens Charter, producing it, thinking it through, and then distributing it. I also want to make one more remark about the use of the camera, and that is, it's not as strong here as in the Großstadt Zigeuner, the Big City Gypsies film, but I think that Moholy-Nagy, by holding the camera on his shoulder and moving with it and showing this motion, is also trying to introduce a kind of proprioceptive experience in the viewer, into the film, or a kinesthetic experience on the part of the viewer.
Kinesthetic. Now we let the audience ask the questions. Does anyone have any questions?
Пожалуйста.
You're welcome.
Actually, a question for Oliver. I wonder if you knew if Moholy-Nagy had any knowledge of Olga Rozanova's works, her works with color, because even though she died before 1921, before Clemens would have come here and had his interactions with the constructivists, she was someone that was very well respected, had been extremely well respected in constructivist circles, and had, Gruber has written about her works with color and the transmission of color, and actually in the journal Anarchy, Gruber wrote about her as being this transmitter of color. So I wondered if there was maybe any way
You know, I've never looked for references to Olga Rozanova in particular in Moholy-Nagy's writings. I mean, you know, it's very possible he would have seen her works at the Galerie van Diemen in Berlin, but I haven't seen an exact. I don't remember whether she appears on the list. I know that I mean, I've always suspected that Popova's pictorial architecture lay behind Lajos Kossák's notion of picture architecture, and again, they would have known this though from black and white reproductions in 1921. So, but I think that there's something more that you're getting at here, and that is sensory education or perception of color or being able to perceive color, because this was the theme in the Russian avant-garde, and I don't know to what extent. I mean, the experiments in Leningrad of Matyushin and others were being transmitted to Germany. I think they weren't really known at that time. And yet, in a sense, in his fascination with, or his sense of the importance of the educating the senses, he was in a sense, he and Hausmann were reinventing what was already being done in Petersburg, Leningrad, a few years before, and what continued to be done. It was one other point of contact, I think, between him and the Russians. So I'm sorry, I can't say much more specifically about Rozanova.
This education of senses was part of propedeutic course at Futemas, developed by Lodovsky. It was the discipline of space. Because there were some exercises to perceive the distance, the shadows. And Lisitsky could tell students about these experiments. And Le Corbusier saw Ladovsky's laboratory. So I guess it's true that some ideas of propedeutics could stream from one area to another, from one country to another. Are there any other questions?
If not, just in between, I could remark, I'd like to respond to your remarks. You know, again, Ladovsky does not, as far as I know, appear in the writings. And it's just perfectly possible that he didn't know about these experiments. However, this was a general interest at the time. Moholy-Nagy's sources were the German pedagogical reform movement and the whole idea of body culture, of movement, of educating the senses through movement. And I showed this image of Moholy-Nagy being touched by a woman from behind. I don't know if you remember this. And I've identified this as being specifically the therapy of Elsa Gindler and the training of Elsa Gindler, who was a German student of Delcroze and Laban. This whole movement of life reform in Central Europe in the early 20th century was behind his particular approach to the education of the senses. But this may be the common source, in fact. So the common source of this almost like an awakening to the body, a bodily turn in the early 20th century, which you know, was common to Western, Central, and Europe, and Russia, obviously.
And to Russia, it came from Germany, apart from Isidor Duncan, but mainly from Germany.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So there you go, yeah, yeah. Any comments? They don't have any questions. They can be your comments on the film or what we've seen.
They have to ask their questions in the microphone, otherwise I can't hear. They have to ask their questions in the microphone, otherwise I can't hear them.
Okay, the question, Mikhail asks, yes, to tell a bit about New Bauhaus and Chicago in Moholy-Nagy, Korea.
Yeah, it's a big subject that I'm just starting to look at now. He was invited by an association in Chicago. Actually, Gropius received the request from an industrial arts association in Chicago to start a school, because by this point, many of the professors of the Bauhaus were in exile in the United States or in England. And Gropius suggested that he said he couldn't do it himself. He was already teaching at Harvard, but that he suggested Moholy-Nagy. So Moholy-Nagy came from England to start the school. It was actually quite a disaster the first year. This very practically minded American association had no idea what Moholy-Nagy was doing, because he was redoing the introductory course where the students were you know, looking, playing with materials, and as far as they could tell, they weren't designing any telephones or motorcycles. So they were outraged and they pulled their funding. So Moholy-Nagy had to save the school by raising his own funds, and so it actually went through three different iterations. But I wanted to say that he really very systematically reintroduced Bauhaus principles at the new Bauhaus, but it almost seems to me as if this whole question of sensory education was even more important in the new Bauhaus. And in fact, in 1942, he held a course for American soldiers who were beginning to come back from the front injured. So they had disabilities, blindness, deafness, missing limbs. And Moholy-Nagy started to think about an artistic education for people who were disabled. But in fact, from Moholy's perspective, they would not have been disabled, but otherwise abled, which is in fact how we like to talk about disability now, as another kind of ability, because of course everyone has a different sensorium. We all perceive things differently. And I think that this was an idea for Moholy-Nagy that became very important through his encounter with disabled veterans of the war. But I could say many more things, but.
Ну что, мне кажется, нам пора заканчивать. Поблагодарим наших участников. Может быть, вы хотите сами еще что-то сказать в заключение? Do you want to say a few words in conclusion?
Спасибо большое. Well, thank you very much. A lot of ideas connecting this in the historical context and the historical perspective on, and then finding out, looking twice or more, much more this film, you are finding out some different layers you didn't realize from looking. And this combination of an intimate of home movie aspects and general theoretical is quite convincing. It's for me, and the question is, well, what's about the places we are living there and finding out new, or looking for new ways and theoretical? And a ship as birthplace of a new vision isn't that bad. Né? Yeah, thank you.
So we had this opportunity to look at the culture of early 20th century that are still relevant today. Because in this book, in this Telehor magazine, there are so interesting discourses based on theoretical ideas, how multimedia art could be, and this appeared much earlier, before real multimedia came to life. Jean-Michel Jarre concerts, music videos, computer technologies, they're all part of popular culture and commercial art. But it's very interesting that László Moholy doesn't really distinguish between popular art and other art. Even though he writes that artists now more dependent on money and they can't really focus on their works properly. So we are looking forward to having this special state of society when artists are going to work for people and not for commercial purposes. So I would like to thank all the participants and all everybody who came, and let's close up here.
Thank you very much. And I just wanted to say one more thing that I think, I'm really, really pleased that we were able to do this in Moscow, in Russia, because as you said, this was the culture that was here at that time was very important for him. And so it's really important for us. It was very important that it be published in Russian. And it's a huge honor for us to be here, and it's specifically in Russia, specifically now, and specifically with a project that really emphasized internationalism and a kind of unity of culture, which international unity of culture. This is very important for us. So thank you very much to all our colleagues and friends here in Moscow who made this possible. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yes, I also want to thank the people of Garage and especially Anna here for moderating this. And we should put the question of the avant-garde again and again, how technical innovations create aesthetic possibilities. Thank you.